Next topic is Dr. Gemini Ganesan Endowment Oration. I now request the chairperson, Dr. M. Arunachalam, to come to the stage, and Dr. A. Sridharan. I now request Dr. Arunachalam to take over the stage.
Congratulations to the new team of IMA Chennai Kodambakkam office bearers. Now, we have the oration. Oration we all know, that is Gemini Ganesan Endowment Lecture Oration. We all know some member of ours has contributed for permanent lecture about his their own liking. Here, whom we have to recall is the famous daughter of the famous actor, Dr. Kamala Selvaraj, who has sponsored the oration in her father's name, who is happened to be Mr. Gemini Ganesan. So we have to appreciate our member who has given. Mr. Gemini Ganesan is remembered as a renowned actor all over the world, but in our IMA, he is a father of such a nice doctor, who is a forerunner in infertility treatment. She is not an ordinary doctor like us. She is an eminent and prominent doctor all over across India. We all know, first, I may be wrong, but in Calcutta and Chennai, they are the IVF children were born 25 years back. So we can be proudly called Dr. Kamala Selvaraj, who has contributed this oration about her father. So the reading goes like this, known as one of the big three of South Indian cinema of yesteryear, that is MGR, Sivaji Ganesan and Ramaswamy Ganesan, acted in several box office hits between 1950-78 as the lead hero. Born on November 16, 19, he was a graduate from an Orthodox Brahmin family and had begun his career as a lecturer in the Madras Christian College, but subsequently began to work with Gemini Studios as an executive from 1947. Hence, he was referred to as Gemini Ganesan. He became a movie film hero by the age of 30 in a movie made by AVM Productions and would soon attain star status. Fondly referred to as King of Romance, he was paired with a number of top-rated heroines of his time, including Vaidyanathi Mala, Saroja Devi, Saukar Janaki and Devika. He ended up getting married to Savitri, another top heroine. He was the proud father of one son and seven daughters. One of his daughters is Bollywood megastar Rekha. He had second daughter named the Gigi, also movie actress in two films. One of his other daughters is a well-known Chennai-based gynecologist, Kamala Selvaraj. Unlike the other big two, Ganesan never tried his hands in politics and continued doing films in Hindi, Telugu, Malayalam, Tamil, Kannada languages, even after his prime, after which he did father roles until the late 90s. The total number of his movies acted in came around 200 in all different languages. A Padma Shri recipient in 1971, Ganesan also won the Kalai Mamani, MGR Gold Medal and Screen Lifetime Award Achievement Awards. After several months of battle, he passed away on Tuesday, 22nd March 2005 at his home. He was 84 of his age. Now I call upon the other co-president, Dr. Co-chairman, Dr. Sridharan, to say a few words and invite our speaker to stage.
Good evening, friends. I'm going to introduce the speaker, Dr. R. Edelson, who is a clinical pharmacologist with areas of interest in reverse pharmacology, pharmacogenomics, and pharmacovigilance. He is an MD in pharmacology from MMC 1987 and MBBS from Stanley Medical College 1982. He has additionally specialized in pharmacogenomics, good clinical practice, and pharmacovigilance. Over the last 35 years, he has held various senior leadership positions in EAD Parry Limited, LifeCall International, Dr. Reddy's Laboratories, USV Limited, and Sun Pharma. He has had hands-on experience in the development of research molecules such as calcipotriol and pantoprazole, and various novel and differentiated products such as Volini, Vibact, Metformin SR, Glycomet GP, and these are amongst the top brands of India and rest of world markets. He is a visiting faculty and resource person to IIT Mumbai, NIT Rajpur, HSC Bangalore, Vellore Institute of Technology, JIPMER, and various medical colleges. His work on a novel sustained release of metformin, sustained release of alpha glucosidase inhibitors, novel oral interleukin 1 inhibitor, advanced glycation and products in CRF patients have been filed for global patents. He has given keynote speeches at various medical education and pharmaceutical industrial platforms such as CPHL, IDMEA and OPPL, Biospectrum and Neutra Summit, Confederation of Indian Industries, FICCI, Global Bio Conference in the USA, and academic platforms such as Indian Pharmacology Society, American Gastroenterology Conference, American Diabetic Association, World Congress on Genomics and Personalized Medicine, and few others. He contributes to Department of Science and Technology and Department of Biotechnology in their expert committee panels and has participated in many new product submission meets in the USA as well. He has conducted scale workshops on in silico drug designing and molecular modeling, target product profiling, PKPD designs in cardiovascular pharmacological and dermatopharmacology, and PK study designing in dermatology. He advises major global consulting firms such as McKinsey and Price Waterhoopers and Deloitte. எனக்கு தெரிஞ்ச இளவரசன் என்னோட க்ளோஸ் ஃப்ரெண்ட், மை கிளாஸ் அவ்வளவுதான். இதெல்லாம் இதுல இருந்தது அப்படியே படிச்சேன். நைஸ் டு இன்ட்ரோடியூஸ் ஹிம்.
Before one of my teachers, Dr. Lakshman Narayanan, you know, I don't know whether he remembers me or not, but I remember him. We learned medicine under him, you know. So he was there in Stanley Medical College and we were all his students. So it's a great pleasure to address when your professor is sitting somewhere for you, you know. It's a great thing. Thank you very much, sir, for being present here. I'll just quickly...
which is the last one.
Okay, so genomics is more of a study of journey inwards. I'm just going to take you a little bit backwards into ourselves. This is the center I work where, you know, I have a laboratory in Pondicherry within Mahatma Gandhi Medical College. It's called the Center for Interdisciplinary Research. And this is me with some of my colleagues there. And this is my, you know, of course, the mentor. We had so the president once visited the place, and you know, Dr. Spetter is my guide, and Dr. Adithan is my direct guide, and I've had the opportunity to speak on vegetarianism and genomics. So that's a topic which is very dear to me. And follower of that, And just I'd like to give you a subject peek into the subject of genomics. Right, all of us know everything, but then, you know, just to give an overview of the gene, right? So this is a very famous, very well-known compound, the molecule, the life molecule, the DNA. The construct is all this base pair, adenine and thymine or cytosine and guanine. This is the basis of our living. Today we are alive because the chemical bond is a covalent bond that exists between that, and that is the basis of our life. The process, you know, we have about a trillion of cells, 1 trillion cell in the body, and each cell has about 46 chromosomes. And these chromosomes, if you uncoil these chromosomes, and then, you know, this is how we end up. If someone has to put this as a ladder and start climbing up, one can go beyond moon. That's the length within what is available in one cell. And typically, this whole coiling, right, this is where this, you know, the molecules move. And I generally love to look at it from a spiritual angle. Although Dr. Chandrasekhar said that science first, spirituality later, but sometimes, you know, when you dwell too much into science, it leads you into spirituality. It's all about dancing. The molecules dancing, and then, you know, we just live in that. This is the central dogma of gene expression, right? DNA has capability to replicate itself, and the DNA transcripts itself. So the step one is DNA getting transcripted is the first pathway into a RNA, right? Normally a messenger RNA, mRNA. This RNA takes the code from the gene, from the DNA, and then translate into proteins. So ultimately it is the protein which starts the, which does all the actions. So from the gene, transcription, translation is RNA to protein. So transcriptomics has become a subject. Genomics has become a subject. Proteomics has become a subject, metabolomics has become a subject, you know, all of them have become huge data-driven subjects by themselves today. And it's very challenging field today. Just to give a quick view, the DNA is a double-stranded compound. The DNA splices at some point, and single strand of DNA is replicated in the RNA form, and then RNA comes between the ribosomes and starts expressing the proteins, and the proteins are manufactured in the ribosomes and get out of the body. So that's how this central dogma comes into actual practice in terms of steps. An interesting point is that DNA sequence is of all human beings is 99.9% identical. We actually have no difference between each of us, right? Does that really stop there? Okay. Our DNA differs by 0.1%. Does it make a difference? Yes. We all know that there are lots of difference between one to another, and that 0.1% difference translates into 3 million separate spelling mistakes. That is, instead of adenine, you have a thymine. Instead of cytosine, you have a guanine. One small spelling mistake, but it's small. It can't be called a spelling mistake, but spelling rearrangement. We're all different. That's all it is. So otherwise, 99.99% of us are the same. So that's interesting. Some of the nomenclatures, usually we call a gene, and then gene expresses a protein. So when you write it in an italized word, it is called gene. When it is written in straight words, it's called the enzyme, right? Now, we very normally talk about genetic polymorphism, right? So what is genetic polymorphism? It's a very normally used word. So just to give an understanding of what is a genetic polymorphism, a genetic polymorphism is a variation in gene, right? Variation in gene, that's all it is. Variation in the gene but occurring at a particular reasonably higher expression, so more than 1% of population, then we call it as single nucleotide polymorphism. If it is less than 1%, we call it mutation. So that particular person has mutation. But the same mutation is expressed in the population, quite a large number, then we call it as polymorphism. Genetic polymorphism is a very common thing. Right? How does it look like? It looks like this. Supposing you have cytochrome N gene, right? And the nucleotide position is, if it is G, if it is C, you have a normal enzyme activity. If it is cytosine, you have a normal Cy activity. If it becomes thymine, the enzyme activity differs. One spelling mistake makes a lot of difference. So the metabolism of a particular drug could, it's not only about the drug, it's also about the disease, but I am restricting myself to the drug. Okay? But the metabolism of the drug could get completely affected. So, as I said, there is a small change. A small change can lead to, this is the wild type or general population, and SNP is a small change of G to thymine. Guanine instead of guanine becomes thymine, right? So SNP can change the protein activity. Just to give a pictorial form, you have the gene expressing the right kind of a cofactor binding, but you know you have a wrong spelling there, and then you know you have a wrong binding, so lower activity. Then I'm not expressing, but there are lots of words to explain the SNP insertions of genes. You know, multiple insertions can occur, deletions can occur. In that, there is a classification of missense, nonsense, and frame shift, and various ways to express how this polymorphism evolved. So this is just to give you a kind of introduction to some of the typical enzymes involved in the metabolism of the drug. A typical enzyme that is the cytochrome P450, very common, most of you would be reading about it, cytochrome P450. And the cytochrome P450, the most common is 3A4, 55% of the enzymes are 3A4, and 2D6 is about 30%, and then 2C9 is about 10%. These are the three enzymes which are very typically involved. And where is this cytochrome located? It's on the surface of the endoplasmic reticulum, on the surface, in a very small appearance, which is, you don't even see the, you know, unless you go to very high magnifications. Right? And this is the chemical structure. So now we'll move into the subject of pharmacogenomics a bit, backdrop. Yeah, the backdrop is, we all know that not all the drugs are effective, right? We do see lots of variations in the efficacy. The antidepressant drugs, only, you know, about meta-analysis shows most of them, about 38 to 40% of patients respond. Asthma drugs, only 40% of the patients respond. So what happens, the rest of the patients are going in for combinatorial medicine, you know, we give multiple medicines and multiple ways of treating. And then, you know, we depend on various other how we can you know, improve the safety of the compound. Another terminology we'll be talking about is pharmacogenetics and pharmacogenomics. Just to know that a single gene variation is study is more of pharmacogenetics, but when you start looking at the whole holistic approach, then you talk about you call it as pharmacogenomics. So this, just to give you an idea. You have this whole population. This is a normal population. When this normal population, the effective cure is pretty much sure. But these guys who have a polymorphism, they don't respond at all. And these guys who have another type of polymorphism, they develop very severe side effects. So what happened in the pre-genomic area, when a prescribing information, you look at it, 66%, 70% improved, right? That is the kind of a clinical efficacy. But in 10% of patients, you'll have side effects like this. Some patients will go in for this kind of a complications and things like that. But which patient is likely to go for which complication was unknown to us. But now we have a reasonable tool. I won't say this, the all but we have a reasonable tool to predict who is likely to go for. Just a small digression here, you may have seen the latest case where a neurologist was fined for carbamazepine prescription. Right? He prescribed carbamazepine to a patient with epilepsy, and the patient developed Stephen Johnson syndrome, was admitted in the hospital at St. John's Hospital. And St. John's Hospital declared that the patient was a case of Stephen Johnson syndrome due to carbamazepine, and the doctor was fined about a lack of rupees. Right? One is the lack of rupees, right? But the doctor was fined for a reason, saying that he prescribed wrongly. The neurologist was asked, was condemned, you know, that he did not know, and the judge had come out and very vehemently had said that how can you prescribe a drug which is known to cause side effects to a patient, right? I read this casually, but then I started to study. That's my habit, so I did my own research. When I started to look at it, the carbamazepine, US FDA has recently given a guideline that carbamazepine prescribers should, patients should undergo HLA-B1502 testing, and if they test positive, carbamazepine should not be prescribed because they have a very high likelihood to develop Stephen Johnson syndrome. Now, then I started to look at what is the India guideline. The India guideline is the Drug Controller General of India has said that since it is already followed by Novartis, there is no need to give a fresh statement because it is already stated somewhere, therefore we keep quiet. That is what the DCGI has said, number one. Number two, DCGI says it is also recommending that all the drug manufacturers to look into this problem and therefore put it in the leaflet. It's only a recommendation, it's not mandatory. In US it is mandatory. It's a recommendation. So no, 68 companies are marketing and none of them have put it in their prescribing information. How is the neurologist likely to know? Is he supposed to follow US FDA or Indian DCGI? Questions. This is not contested in the court. I felt that it was not argued properly. The third is, then I started to analyze further. Supposing if Indian CDSCO has said that you should do HLA-B*1502, are there laboratories? Then I checked for the laboratories. I don't see anyone. So you don't know it. So how do you are expecting the neurologist to prescribe carbamazepine? And carbamazepine is such a drug we all of us use. It's not a fast. I mean, it's such a safe drug. It can cause Stephen Johnson syndrome in some rare, some unknown case. But then, you know, if it happens to be, then how are we going to go? And then the judge comes and says that, you know, you are stupid because you prescribed wrong medicine, knowing that the medicine can cause it. And that all of us know that every medicine can cause side effects. And which drug is there without a side effect? So how can, so we need to educate judges. So as IMA or whatever body, we have a responsibility. So the point is, genomics, we can't brush aside, at least knowledge of genomics and, you know, those kind of things, you know, we need to have. Even we may be coming from multi-diverse, different kinds of, you know, specialty practice. Right, having said that, these are all the possible places where the single nucleotide polymorphism can affect absorption, drug distribution, metabolism, toxicity, excretion, blood, the transport of the drug, even excretion of the drug. At all places, there could be a genetic error that could affect. Supposing there is an excretory problem, there could be over accumulation of the drug, and you know, that could lead to more side effects. So these are all the potential areas already identified. This is one case, clopidogrel, right? Very famous, and all of us, many of us will be taking clopidogrel. The clopidogrel issue, there is one CYP enzyme SNP, there's another PON SNP. This CYP SNP, if it is there, then the absorption itself is an issue. It can lead to 2-oxyclopidogrel formation. Therefore, the absorption of clopidogrel itself will be low. So, if you know that this guy has got CYP, this oxidation deficiency, then you can scale up the dose. So, your dose is not 75, then this patient may require 125 or 150 milligrams per day. So, that's something we need to look at. Or look at non-clubbed bill, some other, you don't depend on clubbed bill, go to something else. You know, your clinical decisions can be better with this. So if you have this polymorphism, right, in a wild type, just to give you an idea, right, in a wild type, homologous wild type, you know, the drug absorption is the drug distribution or drug presence in the blood is about 30, right? When there is a one mutation, it goes to higher level, and double mutation, severe level. So this patient who has got mutant type requires perhaps 15 milligrams of clopidogrel level. Right. So that is how the medicine is now shifting to 3D printing. I mean, there is a 3D printed medicine which is already approved in US for epilepsy. Right, already approved. So which is very likely to come to us maybe in another 1 or 2 years or 3 years time. So 3D printing into the pharmacy, and you know, you tailoring the medicine and prescribing it, and then in the pharmacy makes the medicine and gives it. These are all going to be happening. We would have, we would say no, it's not likely to happen. But in 1997, when I had to look for literature, I had to run from pillar to post to get literature. But today, getting literature is just to switch on the mobile and put a 4G, you get it. So it is only 15 years, everything has changed. So things can change, right? And it is already sometimes changing, right? So this is the era we are in a big data era, data, the genomic data of one person is 4 terabytes. Suppose, you know, we have a laptop like this, which is 500 GB, right? Then 4 terabytes is 8 laptop full of data for one person. So, and then analytics will take you into this. So the importance in terms of metabolism, how they respond, if this gene is deleted, you know, this is a normal case, normal metabolism, and if this gene is deleted, there is no enzyme activity, therefore the blood levels can shoot up, just to give you some idea, right? And if the duplication, there is a very severe metabolism, and therefore the drug could be destroyed completely, just to give you an idea, right? And this is the largest enzyme system present in the body, cytochrome 3A, 4-3. 42% of the enzymes are 3A, 4-3. For example, atorvastatin, clopidogrel, pantoprazole, we prescribe together, right? All of them go through this 3A45. So typically you are overloading this one enzyme system with all the three drugs. So naturally one of them is going to suffer. The most suffering is clopidogrel. So how do we handle that? So pantoprazole is a safer drug. Supposing you prescribe omeprazole and clopidogrel, you're sure to have clopidogrel knocked out. That means, you know, it's only a patient satisfaction. And in terms of importance wise, 3A4 is very important. 2D6 is extremely important, although 2D6 is only 3% of the enzyme constitution. 34% of our medicines are metabolized by 2D6. Very common is that tramadol. You know, all of us prescribe tramadol every day. Tramadol response is 2D6, dependent on the 2D6 polymorphism. So, just to give you an idea of how these are spread. I will skip this, but these are enzyme, phase one enzymes, which have tremendous impact on all these agents. You know, look at this. NSAIDs, TUC9 is mostly responsible for most of the NSAIDs, and TUC19 is for omeprazole. And of course, you know, there are people who take long time to metabolized ethanol, so they may have taken it a week back, still they may be suffering from the hangover, you know, that's a kind of phase one problem. And phase two has, you know, these are the phase two enzymes that are implicated in the polymorphism. And these are typically some of those 2D6 related poor metabolism, right, and issues related to metoprolol primarily. Metoprolol, decreased elimination of the parent compound leads to accumulation and then, you know, severe bradycardia. So you would have given it for a week and then, you know, it would you would be surprised by this patient suffering from such severe bradycardia, mainly because of this poor metabolism of metoprolol. So it gives you an idea of various compounds, right? So let's say take a case of nortriptyline. a person with C2D6 variation, right, from if a normal person requires 150 milligrams, a mutant type requires only 10 to 20 milligrams. Pharmaceutical companies may not think of having this. So this is posing a challenge of how is that, you know, that the Dutch can pull you up, you know, if you are, this is a public domain information, scientific publications. So when it is available, then why did you prescribe 150 milligrams? So you would not have an answer to that. So, but then I think we need to look at practicality and also know to argue better, rather than at least in this case, right? This is the phenetone genotypes. This is the normal type. So if you meet the mean dose of 314, right, variations require smaller and smaller doses. So these are typical products where toxicity is high and you have to tailor it according to the gene-based results. So it's very important, right? This is on the thiazepam side, just to show you how a normal case, the half-life is 20 hours. In a poor metabolizers case, it's about 84 hours. So one tablet, 4 days almost, beyond 4 days. Right? So, and that is half-life, so you could say that spillover benefit is about 5 days, one tablet of compost can make a person feeling at least drowsy or not capable of riding a motor vehicle. So these are implications associated with metabolism. And the Caucasians are little slow metabolizers of most of the sedatives. So we have to be better to be on the lower side. I read a nice poem somewhere. If the patient is old, don't be bold. Keep the drugs to 1 or 2 and a low dose too. Right? It's a kind of a small poem somewhere I read, but it's very interesting. Somebody has written that. So it's not the old only, but then just for Asians, we need a lower dose. Right? So this is just to give you another interesting case where omeprazole metabolism is affected. And in a normal case, right, wild type, the cure rate is about 30%. And you have a mutant case, he is a positive benefit. He benefits, the H pylori eradication is about 60%, and a double mutant case, he improves so fast. So in most of the Helicobacter pylori studies, we have seen that, only some patients respond, but some patients respond beautifully and some patients don't respond. Possibly this explains the reason for that. So the drug transporters, how it affects, these are just some, give you some examples. Especially on the Indian side, we have typically a good number of transportation related polymorphisms. So drugs will get absorbed, but our transportation and delivery into the target tissue may get affected. And we have quite significant variations, almost like most of them, ranging from 40% to 60%. So we have Indian studies, but we do not know within the ethnic variations, whether it is Tamil population, is it different, or it is South Indian population, very different. We don't have a very clear cut, that kind of a demarcation available, but by and large from the genetic pool overall, it's just that Indians do have variations in the transporter situations. So receptor sensitivity again can get affected. Beta 1 receptor gene, if there is a small difference in the glycine, right, with glycine 389, right, instead of arginine 389, if glycine is present in the 389, the patient would not respond to beta blockers. So, no response. The same way, if there is a small difference in the glycine in the 49th position, then there is a very high response to a beta blocker. So this is at the receptor level. Then beta 2 receptor, the guy may not respond to salbutamol one group, and one group will respond much lower, and one group will respond doubly. So there are variations at the receptor level, there are variations at the metabolism level, variations at the absorption level, all related to the genetic makeup of the person. And it gives you a kind of a sensitivity about the subject, how important it is. So ADR, usually the predictable ADR, we call them as type A ADR, and unpredictable idiosyncratic reactions, we call it as type B ADR, right? And this patient has type B, right, with CYP2C9 polymorphism and phenetone toxicity. So typically presented with dual hyperplasia, nystagmus and drowsiness, right? The dose was 300 milligrams, but the phenytoin level was about 3 times higher. So, yeah, this girl will definitely then develop side effects for sulfonylureas, will develop side effects for NSAID, will develop side effects for ERBs, right, will develop side effects for the others, in warfarin. So, one can predict if there is a side effect for phenytoin, then you can extrapolate that this is the one group of family of drugs which is going to be coming through this particular gene. Therefore, you have to be cautious, and one is you could rather get it into a data bank. Therefore, you don't prescribe or you don't allow the other doctor to prescribe. So, is it really practical or not? It's another issue. But then it's a knowledge that's available to you. How do we make this going to happen? Oh, I also don't know. But you have to know it, right? Because tomorrow the judge says that you are supposed to have known this, and you are supposed to have known this. Yeah. That's the answer. So what next? So people talk about it, but at least from my perspective, the new drug trials we have started to hit better. We used to not having Asians in the drug trials earlier. Now the Asian contribution in the major drug trials is quite large. So therefore we have ethnic data. So therefore, that is from my perspective, that is something which we have put it into action and we are doing it. So, and then there are lots of interesting things. All these things that I have presented, we are doing. We have it in Mahatma Gandhi Medical College, and we have this in CDRF, and we do it, right? But we are doing it for research purpose, and we do for, we have interest to do it for the clinicians, but, there are 1,000 things for the clinical practice, right? So you tend to push this aside as too much of news or too much of new knowledge. I'm not interested. So what happens is, it's still not bought. It's going to be bought, but then it's not right now not bought yet. Right? So it's the beginning of a long journey, but the journey has begun. That's what I can say. The journey has begun, and this is what I look at the whole thing. I just would look at the whole thing coming down to what Manika Vasudev has said in this one of his poems called Thiru Anda Pagadi, and that he says Anda Pagadi in Undaipirakkam. அளப்பெருந்தன்மை வளப்பெரும் காட்சி ஒன்றருக்கு ஒன்றாய் நின்ற ஏழில் பகரின் 101 கோடியின் மேற்பட விரிந்தன இன்னுழை கதிரின் துன்னணுப்புறைய சிறியாக தெரியும் தெரியும் the light when it comes to the light through the light you see a lot of dust particles floating that's how the galaxy is floating and he wrote it in several centuries back and he says முழுவதும் படைப்போன் படைக்கும் பழையோன் படைத்தவை காப்போன் He says God is the old fellow, right? That old fellow knows everything, right? படைத்தவை காப்போன் காக்கும் கடவுள் காப்பவை காப்போன் என்றும் எனை பல கோடி What is there inside is எனை பல கோடி I'm not one, I'm 1 crore. And what is above me is 1 crore. Right? This is what he says. So, முன்மோன் காண்க, முழுதோன் காண்க, தண்ணீர் இல்லாதான் காண்க. That's how Manika Vasudev completes. So he has understood genomics about some 12,000 years and he had understood astronomy also. Thank you very much.
Remembering me, after 40 years, I was in Stanley as a teacher from 1975 to 82, then I left. It's a wonderful lecture you gave. And yesterday, there was a diabetes debate national conference. I was sitting in the second row. One of the speakers suddenly said, my teacher, Professor Lakshmi Narayan, is sitting in the second row. I was surprised how it, and it is advantage of your teachers. Thank you very much, and thank you for recognizing us in the forum. But seldom people do it. He touched, Dr. Anderson touched, very important subject, very high level talk. Today I was your student and you are my teacher. And about this genomics, in the debate yesterday we were talking, what will be the future in treating diabetes? So when the patient comes today, I have to break my head. What actually to me, after going to several doctors, he comes to me. So already has received so many drugs. So what drug is the best drug I can give so that I can sustain my practice? Then, what is the future of treatment of diabetes or any disease in future? The genomics has to be put in the computer. And computer tells us he'll be responding to glibenclamide or sulfonylureas or thiazinedioxidase or gliptins. And he rightly pointed out for one abnormality, you can now use glipizide, glibenclamide, many diabetic drugs you said. So it is going to be the future. So when a patient, a chronic patient comes, rheumatoid arthritis, bronchial asthma, so put it in the computer, you know. Then it will tell us, you, then all will be successful doctors. Right. And about this carbamazepine, I am damn afraid of this. I am very allergic to that drug. Because one patient I lost in Ramchandra Medical College by giving carbamazepine for diabetic neuropathy. Even now I see so many doctors are prescribing carbamazepine, but I never go there. Fortunately, there was no medical legal case. Anyway, this is a wonderful talk and a lot of carry home messages, and it's a very high level talk. Actually, I came here, I had to thank Dr. Chandrasekhar. I came here to get signature for my FSS 2. Thank you, Chandrasekhar. Because of you, I had such a wonderful lecture. Thank you very much. It's a great honor for me.
Thank you.
Please take the photograph.
Thank you.
Photo. I'll take a
picture.
I will take for you.
Oh, I hear the
photograph. I'm really honored.
Last executive council meeting, we decided to send the national, you know, our view on the National Medical Council Act, right, the NMC Act. Dr. Chandrasekhar had also circulated. The government has already floated this NMC for NMC bill for public opinion. So it has already come in the in the public domain, and it. And so all members have to please do log in and put in your objection. Right? This is the objection letter that goes on behalf of our branch. And I'll just quickly give you an overview of what we have written. We have opposed the following provisions which are damaging. Number one, introduction of licentiate examination which will additionally filter the number of healthcare professionals coming out. It is not conducive in the fair and legitimate interests of those who belong to other communities. Provision for bridge course would result in a backdoor entry. Marginalization of state representation. Infringement of democratic representation character. Marginalization of state medical council. Discretionary power. Discretion with regards to imposing penalty, discretion of central government to do away with the conflict of interest, and all powers rest vested with the central government. These are some of the key points we are objecting to. It's being signed by all office bearers here, and we would request those who are okay with that could also sign and write your name below that. Right? We will circulate it right now. Kindly spare a minute for our fellow professionals and please to sign and carry on, and then we would definitely like to represent all of you with the members of parliament here in Chennai, all the three members of parliament. Right? So I'm signing and then I will put it on circulation.